I'm Chris Stafford, and this is Art, the podcast where we get to know the women behind their art. If you don't feel it, I'll make you feel it. I'll show you what I mean. If you don't feel it, I'll make you feel it. I'll bring you to your knees if you follow me. My guest this week is American conceptual artist Kathryn Andrews. Kathryn was born in Mobile, Alabama in 1973, the only child of Judy, an entrepreneur, and Lamar, a salesman and erstwhile poet. Kathryn's early days were transient because her family's business determined where they lived. Her childhood influences in terms of culture, politics, and religion would form the backdrop to her emergence as an artist. Her formal art education began with a BFA from Duke University and an MFA from the Art Center College of Design in Pasadena, California. She also studied photography at the Rochester Institute of Technology in New York prior to becoming interested in sculpture. She says that initially she did not consider being an artist. Working in mixed media came later. Kathryn spent time traveling through Europe and working a range of jobs, including with Bosnian refugees in Slovenia. She then spent 5 years in Manhattan as a researcher and working for the fine art photographer Rosalind Solomon. Kathryn then moved to Los Angeles in 2000 and began exhibiting her work in 2002. She has exhibited in numerous shows, both shared and solo, as well as holding performances at institutions, including the Broad Art Museum at Michigan State University in 2017, and the Museum of Contemporary Art in Chicago in 2015, the Highline New York in 2016, and the Museum Ludwig in Cologne, Germany in 2013. Kathryn is the founder of the Judith Center, which seeks to engage women artists, activists, and thought leaders in conversation around the topic of gender equality. It will launch in the spring of 2024, with 50 artists featured in 30 museums over the next 5 years. Meanwhile, Kathryn's work will be featured in a new exhibition at the Kunstmuseum Thun in September 2023, called Not My Circus, Not My Monkeys. Kathryn lives in Los Angeles with her two Bedlington terriers, Coco and Cooper. Hi, Kathryn. Welcome to the podcast.
Hi, Chris. Thank you. Glad to be here.
Well, you know, the first thing I'm going to talk about is the dogs. Two Bedlington terriers. Tell us a story about your two dogs.
Story of my dogs. Well, I have two wild and woolly dogs, Cooper and Coco. They're Bedlington Terriers. They hail from Pennsylvania. They're an unusual breed in the U.S., partially because they can have genetic disorders. And so a lot of breeders don't mess with that. But they were bred by a woman who's sort of a mad scientist, who lives in the hinterlands, and I learned about her, and I had met a Bedlington Terrier that belonged to a friend of mine, and I fell madly in love, and so it just was time for me to get one. And then I got that one, and I enjoyed it so much. A few years later, I got the second one.
Are they related?
They are cousins.
Well, they look adorable, and I'm glad I met at least one of them on your Zoom photo. So that tells me a little bit about you, you see, that you're a dog person.
Yeah, I'm actually a cat person, but I'm allergic, so I've become a dog person by default. It's an acquired taste for sure.
Have you always been a dog person, a cat person, an animal person? What did you have as a child?
I did have a lot of animals as a child. I had rabbits. One of them ate the other one. That was interesting. I had hamsters, I had birds, I had dogs, I had mini cats. I had all sorts of animals. Oddly, they seem to meet odd fates, you know, as they will. We sometimes lived in rural areas and they would disappear, get hit by cars. So though I loved animals deeply, my relationship to them was sort of odd because of their strange demise.
And what about horses? Did you ride? Because you grew up in Alabama.
I had a very good friend from school whose family raised Arabian horses, and she would compete. And we would often ride horses at her place. And that was really exciting. We would ride them bareback. Sometimes we put the little cart behind them and ride around in the car, which would be quite funny. You would hope that the horse wouldn't have a bodily moment, let's put it that way, while you were behind it. But yeah, I have some fond memories of that.
Of childhood, generally, how was your childhood growing up in Alabama?
It was interesting. I mean, you know, it's when you're in your own childhood, it's hard to compare it to others. You're just in yours, right? But my mother and my stepfather were entrepreneurs, and they had a couple small businesses at the time. But one of the primary ones was a fast food fried chicken franchise. So we moved every couple of years to open up a new store. So we lived all over Alabama in lots of small towns, some bigger ones. So my childhood was pretty interesting, actually, because I saw the way that a lot of different kinds of people live. Contrary to popular belief, Alabama is not a homogeneous place. There are a lot of different people there, different values, different cultures. And in the chicken stores, I actually would go as a child and sometimes hang out there, work there. And so I met a lot of people in the stores also, both working there, customers. So it was interesting. I was exposed to a lot that, you know, a white girl in Alabama might not be.
And as the only child, was that, you know, how you socialized, you know, or did you have playmates as well and girls that you'd go on adventures with and explore?
I had playmates also. I also had playmates. Yeah, I did. I have lots of fond memories of lots of different playmates, actually. But the other part of the story I didn't mention is that at a certain point, my mom decided to go back to school. She had not completed her college degree. I was born when she was 21, and that probably seems crazy young now, but at the time, that was fairly normal. This was in the early 70s. So she decided to go back to college. She completed a bachelor's degree. Then she went to law school, and then she got a tax law degree after that, an LLM. So that also sort of fed into the mix. And that was quite interesting because my mom was unusual compared to the mothers of the other kids I knew. One, she was pursuing a career, which wasn't that common at that time for a lot of women that were married. Maybe the model was to stay at home, take care of kids. But she went on to do several different things after that, one of which was she became a partner in a law firm, and there were 40 partners in the firm, and she was the only female partner. So a lot of my childhood was also impacted by seeing this experience of her trying to navigate the sort of resistance against a woman coming up through the system.
Did you feel that as a young adult then, when you were making your way?
I don't know. I don't think that I experienced the same barriers that she did. I think things had moved quite far by the time I was a young adult, you know, in the 90s. I don't remember when women could start having credit cards. That was the late 60s, early 70s. You know, it's like fast forward 20 years later. It's pretty different. Yeah. Not to say I don't experience sexism. I frequently have. But I think in general, the playing field was a little bit different.
So what was childhood like sort of creatively for you? Because you obviously think well outside the box with your art. Did it begin in childhood?
I remember we used to have a giant Buick, and I would sit in the back. My parents would sit in the front, and they'd be talking about business stuff. And I would just sit in the back and kind of tune out and look out the window. We'd just watch the landscape, watch the electric wires. That was fun. I always loved watching the electric wires. Like if you follow that line, it's like an animated film. In a funny way, it was so mundane, but that experience of just looking and just really being curious about the world and looking outside, and also this experience of moving from place to place to place, sort of shaped my interest in thinking about how there's so many different things out there, how they're different, and just really having this experience of looking at things and seeing things visually, taking them in. That was part of it. No one was painting in my family. My dad is actually, he was kind of a casual poet and a very funny man, not an artist, but a free spirit for sure, a kind of flaneur. And probably some of my early years with him, maybe it just like runs in the blood. I don't know. There was some influence there.
And how about your mother? Did she influence you at all? Did she direct you, or did she leave your mind alone?
She was very encouraging to me to do whatever I wanted. She didn't force anything on me. She didn't have great ambitions for me. She more wanted me to just follow whatever it is that interested me. I think her own willingness to try out different things, whether it was a new business or to go back to school later, or she and my stepfather have had multiple businesses that have been very sort of unusual and successful. Just the model of seeing her curiosity and willingness to go into the world, I think more than anything that shaped some of what I have done as an artist. But what she was doing wasn't in the field of art, but it was more an openness to the world that it's out there. I have this idea. I want to do it. Let's go for it. Let's get out there. Let's do it. There's not a huge art scene in Alabama. There is a history of art making there, a lot of folk art. Of course, there are museums, but it's not a huge part of the culture, the day to day. You know, fishing is very important there, hunting, maybe quilting, knitting, more craft oriented things. So I wasn't inclined to become an artist early on. It didn't occur to me. I actually, when I was very young, first I wanted to be a veterinarian, and then some years later that changed. But I wanted to become a politician. That really interested me. And I did a program as a teen, must have been when I was 16 or 17. It was called Presidential Classroom. And many high schoolers from around the U.S. go to D.C. and they learn all about the systems of government. And after I did that, and I was so excited about it, I remember. And after I did that, I totally changed and said, hell no, I'm not going into politics. It's too messed up. I met my state senator and congressman, and I was just so disappointed, even as a teen, in the systems of government, sort of seeing some of the folks we met putting on airs, I'll call it that. And I was pretty turned off. So after that, I wasn't really sure what I might do. I had a friend in high school who, our last year of high school, who switched, he opted out of physics and started taking a photography class. And I was really surprised when I learned about this, because I didn't even know that our school had a photography class. So I marched to the principal's office and I said, well, he's doing it. Why can't I do this thing? And they said, yep, you can do it too. So I went to the dark room and I started learning about it, and I was hooked immediately. That was the first time I really came to art, and I was just sort of blown away. I was like, oh, this is what I want to do.
So was it photography then that was the first appeal for photo art, that you could do things with photography?
No, it was straight photography, just really very old-fashioned, traditional, working with the camera, photographing places, people, all that kind of thing.
You know, how about your earlier other influences in terms of arts? And did you visit museums and galleries and have that kind of access to art generally? Is that something your mother took you to, or you discovered them yourself?
We did not go to museums very much, no. I knew a tiny bit. You know, I knew about Picasso or maybe Matisse or something. I think we weren't so minded about art. We must have gone to Washington, D.C. when I was a kid and went to some of the museums there. I remember I visited New York when I was in high school once, and I don't know if we went to museums there. Surely we did, but it didn't make a big impression. I didn't come to art really until I was a college student. So I had decided I wanted to do photography. I knew that. I went to Duke as an undergraduate. I needed to get a job. I needed to make money. So I applied for a work study job and got hired in the art history department in the slide library. And at that time, they had a position. This is quite funny because we're in such a different reality now with the onset of AI and everything else. All the professors, the different art history professors, would bring in books to the art history slide library and say, oh, I want to teach this subject to my students. So the slide librarians would photograph the books, produce color slide film, and someone's job was to cut up the slide film and tape out every picture with silver tape and then put it into this plastic slide sleeve, right? And so then the slide could be used by the professor and they could do their lectures. So my job, which I did for several years, was to tape thousands and thousands of these little images. So that's how I learned art history. I just consumed, you know, all these images, talked with the librarians about it, talked with many of the professors about it as they were coming in and out, looked at the books, and it was an amazing education, actually.
Were there any other mediums that you enjoyed then when you were younger, before you took the route that you did?
I wasn't thinking about art. It wasn't in my consciousness. One of the funny things was one of the first artists that I encountered was Stellark. He's an artist who put hooks in his body and suspended himself so that his skin would sort of pull into these drape-like forms, almost like he's a tent or a piece of fabric, and he would suspend himself all over. So I just skipped, you know, all the basics and went straight to the hardcore stuff. So, you know, I was very naive. I must have been 18. I'm fresh on the job, and they're like, okay, this is what you're going to do, you know? And so this is what was thrown at me, and this was one of my early encounters with art.
So you mentioned that you went to Duke University in Durham, North Carolina, and you got your Bachelor in Fine Arts. And then you went to the Art Center College of Design in Pasadena for your Master's. Was there a time in between that you were discovering what you really wanted to do?
There was. So I got to Duke, and at that time, they didn't have much of an art department. But they did have some very interesting things going on in relation to photography. Actually, one of the first teachers I had was Bill Noland, who is the son of Kenneth Noland, the painter, and is the brother of Katie Noland. And I learned the basics of photography from Bill, and that was just terribly exciting for me. Then, at the same time, Duke had created, shortly prior to that, the Center for Documentary Studies. And there were quite a few people there teaching on the idea of documentary, you know, what it was, what it had been historically, what it could be. And that was very interesting. At first, that appealed to me a lot. And then I came to find that a bit conservative. That's complicated, but it has to do with sort of the history of photography, how it evolves, and it's sort of in a relationship to different political histories and how within the sort of height of what might be called modern photography, there's a real romanticism about political struggle. So at a certain point, I got a little frustrated with that. At the same time, I was taking a lot of classes in the history department at Duke and looking at different, I could only say like histories of civil war and lots of different countries, and also the ways in which that had been depicted in different documentaries and by different filmmakers using different styles. At a certain point, I met Christine Stiles, who is a really brilliant art historian at Duke. And at that point, things shifted for me. I think that's when I first learned about contemporary art. I just began to think about it more deeply. I wasn't so interested in art because I was coming out of Alabama and I was processing the very, very intense racism there, the very, very intense sexism there, the influence of many different religious groups who are proselytizing and who have a really big sort of impact on stuff down there. I was looking at that and trying to understand my relationship to having grown up around that and what my own ideas were. I was really processing my identity in relation to a very intense political history, and contemporary art seemed quite silly, theatrical, surface, not that powerful in comparison to what I was looking at that time. So even though I did meet Christine and she invited me to curate this show at Duke called like Soho at Duke, that shows how old it was. They would invite students to go to Soho and look at the latest art and then make some exhibition on campus. She invited me to do that and I turned it down because I just thought contemporary art was silly. But something shifted some years later and I came back around. But I will say, Christine, though I didn't join her in that early moment, she turned a light bulb on for me that later I could use. In her own work, she was looking at histories of trauma, the impact of like nuclear waste sites. She had a very broad interest, and it wasn't so much about art in my mind as much as it was about certain political histories and artists responding to those histories. So that did make an impact and sort of stuck with me. You had asked about how I came to Art Center, sort of what happened in between. There was a period of some years after Duke and before I moved to Art Center where I was trying to figure out which direction I was headed. And I moved to New York. I worked for a photographer for a year, Rosalind Solomon, who is a sort of classic, you might call her a street photographer. She had trained and studied under Lisette Modell. She's in her 90s now, I believe. You know, Diane Arbus also trained with Lisette Modell, and Rosalind's work has a lot of overlap with Diane Arbus's work, but she was an adventurer. It's shocking if you look at the places she went to over the course of her life and all the different people that she met and all the different situations that she encountered. So, you know, little old me, what do you want to say? Like hillbilly from Alabama. I did go to Duke, so I met a few folks there, but, you know, I moved to New York fresh out of college and I was very naive. And to encounter Rosalind was pretty impressive because of her history and what she had seen in her lifetime. So from there, I thought that I might go down a more traditional photography path. So I actually went to Rochester Institute of Technology for a master's and started that there. And that was quite interesting. But after working there for about a year, I grew disillusioned with photographing people to talk about, you know, different situations. I mean, by different situations, I mean like topics that are political, let's say. I felt like it was exploitative to photograph people. So I shifted and thought, okay, well, this isn't working. This is not how I want to engage people. So maybe I need to make objects to photograph. Maybe I could reconsider this idea about the possibility of what categorically was referred to as contemporary art there is. And so I revisited what I had rejected. I began making things and photographing them. And that actually became very appealing to me, but I wasn't able to do that in Rochester because the school was strictly photography and one couldn't make more sculptural things there. The setup wasn't allowed. There wasn't commingling between the mediums. So at that point, I decided it was time to actually go somewhere else. So I left Rochester and looked at the U.S. at all the different schools that were interdisciplinary. And there were only a handful at that time. There was Columbia, there was Art Center, and there was UCLA. I also looked at CalArts, but photography was separated from the other mediums at CalArts at that time. And so that's how I came to Los Angeles, because Art Center was really, really very mixed up. And that was very attractive to me.
What mediums were you using for those things that you were making to photograph then before that you mentioned, Kathryn?
Found objects, clay, latex. I had been photographing people. So my first impulse was, oh, I'll photograph figures. So I was looking at probably dolls, different things I find in thrift shops, kind of simple forms one might find in art stores. I began photographing those things. And I had this quite funny experience. I applied to Art Center. I got very fixated on it. I was like, this is the school, you know, this is where I really want to go. And I sent in my application, and it was a portfolio of pretty traditional street photography. That's what I call it. That's what I've been doing up until that time. I knew when I applied that, you know, it wasn't the right thing to be applying with, but I didn't have much else to show at that time. That was all there was. So I went ahead with it and I got rejected. And I had a friend that was in school there at the time. And so we were talking about it. And I said, they don't understand, you know, I'm leaving this direction I've been in, but I don't have the portfolio that shows that or whatnot, you know. And he was like, yeah, I hear you. You know, maybe you need to call the chair. So I said, that's a good idea. So I called up the chair and I said, you know, I think you've made a mistake. I really think that we're the right fit. So he laughed and he said, come on out and let's chat, you know. So I did. I flew out and I met different people teaching there. I happened to sit in on an admissions meeting, and that was very interesting. It was exactly what you might think in the worst way. You know, it's like, oh, well, who wrote the recommendation? Oh, we know them. Okay, let that one in. And beyond that, I also saw what the students applied with, the prospective students. And after that, I was like, oh, this is easy. I just have to throw together some crazy shit. This is no big deal. So I went back to Rochester. I was still living there. And I remade my portfolio in some haphazard, thrown together, crazy ass way, and resubmitted it a couple months later and was admitted. And that was that.
So was it at that time then you really firmly believed in yourself? You had the self-confidence to be able to pursue a career in art, that this could be a lifestyle and actually pay the rent?
No, not at all. For me, I never had confidence in what I was doing. It was more just a draw or a pull. There was just this strong force saying, this is where you must go. This is your direction. This is it. It was just an energetic pull, really. It's the only way I can describe it. And it wasn't until probably even a decade later until I began to have any clue about what I was actually interested in making and what I wanted to do. You know, there was a period from when I was very young until when I was 2008. I don't know how old I was at that point. Let's run that little math. But it took me a very, very long time to understand what I was actually trying to do.
Well, I'm wondering if you found that this was a period in your life of self-discovery then, and that's how it interpreted into your art.
Yeah, I think for sure, absolutely. I mean, I'm still in that period of self-discovery, so it's definitely not done. Maybe all artists are, right? I think my own trajectory was so confusing because sort of the values of my parents, they were extremely open-minded and extremely accepting of difference and sort of quite radical by comparison to other people that we were surrounded by in Alabama. And that wasn't always altruistic. You know, some of it was because they needed to be in order to come along with all different kinds of people to make their business successful. And I was really grappling with what that meant in relation to being surrounded by people that were very racist, sexist, extremely religious, you know, all sorts of things like that. And so I was pretty confused by the time I left And it took me some time to make sense of those values and my own relationship to them. Every now and then I meet people who grew up in New York or who grew up in LA or some big city. And I'm like, oh, you're so lucky. You got to be exposed to all these different models and really see the world and understand that there is a big world and how it can work. You know, I think it took me a long time to come to terms with my own relationship to this very backward way of being.
You moved to LA in 2000. Was that because you realized then after you graduated that that was going to have to be where you discovered your future?
When I got to New York in the 90s, I was pretty blown away. You know, even though up until I was 18, I was in Alabama and we did move a lot. You know, I was mentioning in some ways I was very provincial, but we did move a lot and I did have a concept of differences out there. And so when I turned 18, I had normalized that experience of, oh, one could be emotion. One could go to the next place and see the next bit of stuff. And one could go again and then meet these people and then go over there and meet those people. The word peripatetic pops in my mind. And when I was in college, I actually lived many places in the summer. I also did travel abroad. I lived in Slovenia and worked as a volunteer with refugees from the Bosnian War. You know, I lived in Paris. I traveled all over. I lived in Oregon. I lived in Texas. I lived in Wyoming. I was moving around a lot. And when I got to New York, I was so excited because I was like, okay, I don't have to move. I can just like walk through Brooklyn, you know, and just see all these different cultures here together or side by side. So I really was so excited. I felt like I had found a place that made more sense for me. And then when I came to this idea that I needed to understand how to work in multiple mediums to say what I was interested in saying, and I had to find the place to do that, all the signs pointed to Los Angeles. But I wasn't excited about leaving New York. I didn't want to leave New York. I didn't like California. I didn't like Los Angeles. But I could just tell there was something going on there that was bigger, that was related to what I was interested in, and that it just made sense to go. So I kind of went there, even though it was against what I wanted, but I somehow had this feeling or knew that it was what I needed to do. And then once I got to LA, I had to make this decision. I was like, okay, Kathryn, this is getting a little crazy. Like, you can't just be a rolling stone. You know, at a certain point, you're going to have to dig in and commit. And so I made the decision that LA is just where I would do that, that I would sort of slow down and try to go deeper. Instead of just staying on the surface and moving around, I would try to stay in one place and kind of go down vertically or just dig in deep, entrench.
And does it still seem like the right fit for you all these years later?
I do think LA is very good for me. I think it's very good for artists in general because this has changed quite a bit. And even in the last few years, it's really changed with all the galleries moving here, so many artists, lots of institutions popping up. Now it's quite a bit more social than it had been. But because of the distances, because of the traffic, also because of the sun creates this sense that there's infinite time. There are no seasons. There's no urgency. You know, it's pretty much the same here, day in and day out. I mean, there's some exceptions, June gloom. But because of all that, artists get an opportunity here to really be on their own and to individuate. And I think that that is very good for artists. They get to have time with themselves and to come to what they're doing without having to worry so much about how it fits what everybody else is doing.
And your work really evokes so many different feelings, as art is meant to do, to really make us look at it in a new way. And I'm wondering how much now, you talked about politics, history, how much of that influences your art, either consciously or subconsciously, when you later stand back and review it?
That is definitely in there. I'm just thinking because, you know, I'm possibly working on a text soon about Mike Kelly, and I've been thinking a bit about his own relationship to being what I would call an identity artist, which is kind of funny because I don't know that Mike is always thought of as an identity artist. But as a student, I studied with Mike, and then I went on and worked for him for almost a decade up until his passing in 2012. And I'm bringing him up because his own work really explored the oppression of culture being kind of forced upon you. And he looked at different cultural forms and their relationship to very complicated social histories, histories of violence. And he was so brilliant and funny, and he was so playful and creative. He could take all of that and distill it down in a way and serve it up to the people that everybody could enjoy it, connect to it, and understand exactly what he was talking about. But in many ways, I think he is such an important artist in the late 20th century, looking at the idea of what does it mean to have an identity that you don't connect with. You know, right now, I think we've shifted to definitely looking at many groups that have been oppressed in the last centuries in the United States. And we don't tend to think of the white man as a figure that's been oppressed. But Mike's work did look at that. And I think it might be interesting to reconsider it more in this moment right now in relationship to what he was saying about masculinity. And there are many other artists kind of his era or his generation that were looking at similar questions. You know, Cindy Sherman's a very obvious one. One of my favorite artists is Lutz Bacher, who passed away. I love Sturtevant. I mean, Picabia is probably my favorite, one of my favorite early modernists who sort of charted out this territory. But all these artists, one of the things they have in common is looking at this question of how we define ourselves in relation to what's around us, you know, the social situations we're born into and the sort of many conflicts that are going on all the time. And my own work definitely deals with questions about that. It looks at histories of violence. It looks at how those histories intermingle with histories of aesthetics. And I try to position how I use materials and how I use forms and how I'm perceived as a woman in relation to those histories of violence, in relation to those histories of aesthetics. I'm very conscious of all that, and I'm trying to wrangle all that in any given artwork. I don't do it the same every time. I'm not a factory artist that makes widgets and this piece and that piece and that piece are all similar. I try to move from one piece to the next, probably in a way, you know, repeating the movement of my early childhood. It's just such a natural thing for me. I mean, it's probably a curse for me as an artist as well. The market likes an artist that just does the same thing all the time. So the market can identify it, pin it down, consume it, commodify it, whatnot. But for me, that just hasn't been so interesting. I like the freedom. I like the unknown. I like the going into the challenge and trying to see what can come of all that.
So if we were to meet at a party and I asked you if you did, what would your answer be?
Yeah, well, that's a complicated question, Chris. I actually, in addition to being an artist, I'm a therapist. I went back to school sort of recently and got a master's in clinical psychology. And so now, in addition to making art, I work with trauma patients. And that is very fascinating. So I might answer that I'm an artist, but depending on who you are, I might answer that I'm a therapist. I also recently formed a 501c3 called the Judith Center. And it's looking at the current state of sexism in the U.S. It invites artists to collaborate with us to address that. And we work with a lot of institutions, university art museums and whatnot, and put on programming. So at least that's my vision for what we're going to do. We're launching next spring, and we're going to be addressing a lot of different topics that are very pressing in the U.S. right now in relation to gender equality. So I might answer that I run a 501c3. So
there's a choice of answers there. And I was going to come to that, of course, because you had told me that you were doing this. So this really speaks to gender politics and sexual politics of the day. And this is quite a large undertaking. You were telling me that you now have 50 artists, 30 museums, and it's, you know, it's a multi-year project. Give a sense of what this is going to do when it launches in 2024, how people can engage with this.
We will have a website, an Instagram page, hopefully a YouTube channel. Everyone wants me to make a podcast. We'll see. I'm not as skilled at that as you, Chris. I'll be calling you soon to get some pointers. Our programming will happen primarily in collaboration with university art museums, and we will be working with them to exhibit. We're starting off with the poster project, and 50 American self-identified women artists will be commissioned to make posters on a range of different topics. And, you know, the different institutions we're working with already have audiences. They have infrastructure to help promote this. And in conjunction with exhibitions, we'll be doing programming with the institutions to look at issues that are really pressing locally in different regions in the U.S. I should probably tell you why this seemed like a good idea. Part of it for me came out of thinking about sexism in the art world, how to deal with that, as well as just sexism at large. I think I was thinking a lot about that during the Trump presidency, you know, particularly with the election and all of the sort of conversation about violence against women's bodies that occurred in relation to that. And I just felt like it was such an important topic.
This is really, really important. And I'm wondering what kind of legacy you hope this will bring, given the subject matter that you're embracing with this. It's a huge project.
It is a big project. I'm a very, very good delegator, trained by these wild entrepreneurs. So somehow I seem to be able to do it. I also don't have kids, so I am able to spend the time on it that some women would be doing differently, let's say, if they're raising families, or men raising families, or any person of any gender identity, however that goes. But I don't see it necessarily as different than my work. You know, I see my artwork being informed by work with trauma patients. I see, you know, what I'm learning in the sort of psychoanalytic space is informing my understanding of what's going on culturally at large in terms of the many places where sexism plays out and how it plays out and why it plays out. And, you know, I'm taking all of that and reflecting upon it as I'm making artworks. In many ways, I feel like it's bringing me closer and closer to what it is I'm interested in, what I want to say, and my own output as an artist.
Continuing your journey of self-discovery, then.
That's right. My latest sculpture, it just was exhibited this past week, or is it on view right now at David Kordansky Gallery in conjunction with his 20th year of running the gallery. He has an exhibition that's a anniversary sort of exhibition. My latest artwork that came out there is a sculpture of breasts filled with hundreds of thousands of dollars of shredded U.S. currency. And they're made out of stainless steel and glass, and it's a lot of fun. So for me, you know, that piece is maybe the fusion of like Kleinian ideas, British object relations about the good breast, the bad breast. How is a culture, how are we looking at the body and our relationship to it? What we want to do with it? How is the breast seen as this form that operates in culture? How do dollars move through the systems at large? Where do they go? What kind of value do they retain? You know, that's some of the literal stuff. There's a lot more symbolic stuff, but these are things that I enjoy thinking about. That piece was a lot of fun to make. It's actually a very complex piece, the way it was engineered. But when you see it, it looks as if machines have just formed it, but that's not the case. You know, there was tons of handwork involved to achieve the kind of precision that exists in the artwork. I love it. I like complex problems. I like thinking through all the different variables and trying to make something from that.
Well, and then I can imagine you standing back to photograph it too and photograph it from every angle.
Yeah, someone took a picture of me next to it. It's kind of funny. I don't have very large breasts, so that's rather amusing.
Are there any favorite materials that you work with now? Because you seem to work in so many different mediums.
I work in a lot of materials, but I like working in metals, primarily because they can be additive and subtractive. For example, wood, you can cut it, but you can't put it back together with itself seamlessly. You know, there's always a seam. And with metal, you can melt it, you can weld it, you know, you can do that with other things too. You can do that with resins or, well, I don't know. There are some, I suppose you could like heat certain things and put them back together, but some of the other things you can do that with are pretty toxic. And for some period, I dated a sculptor who had worked a lot with that. And, you know, there was some illness that came out of that. So I just decided I wasn't going to go down that route. There's so many possibilities with different kinds of metals, and I just really enjoy that. But it depends on the application. You know, you can do certain things with some in this situation, certain things with that in another situation. It's always different. So for me, it's not about preferring a particular material. It's more about what kind of form am I trying to make and what material can make that form or can be used to make that form.
I know you have a sense of humor, so I'm wondering what kind of remarks you've overheard of people looking at your works, at your sculptures, which are very different, and they really are thought-provoking. So in any funny moments, Kathryn?
My favorite moment as an artist, seeing someone who viewed my work, must be when I made this giant wall sticker at the MCA Chicago that was a backdrop for a sculpture I'd made. And the show really addressed questions about how different people with different identities, whether it's women or whether it's African Americans or whether it's, you know, whatever group it is, how they can access power within the U.S. And the exhibition was looking in particular at the entertainment industry as a place where people have been able to move in ways they haven't been able to in other professional fields. So I made this giant sticker that depicted, it must have been Nancy Reagan sitting on Mr. T's lap during the 80s when she was doing her big anti-drug campaign. I was trying to remember if it was her on Mr. T's lap or Mr. T on her lap. But anyway, and it's behind this sculpture I've made. And so it's up. And one day I get this photo of Mr. T himself, the actual Mr. T, has come to the exhibition and done a whole photo op in front of the piece, in front of the sticker next to the sculpture. That was very exciting for me. That was a good day. I love Mr. T as a kid. I love Mr. T. He's one of my favorites.
And what are you looking most forward to next? Do you have another project in the studio? I'm wondering how much time you have for your art.
I have a lot of time for my art. I'm in the studio 4 days a week, also nights and weekends if needed. I, you know, bring in as many people as we need. So we make it happen. We get it done. I am looking forward to a big installation I'm working on that will be on view at the Kunstmuseum Thun, which is in Switzerland. It will open in September. It's part of a group exhibition on artists who have worked with the circus. And I am debuting a new installation as well as a new video work, which is something new for me. I've never made a video piece before. And this work is going to be a combination of animations of many performances as well as photo shoots that I've done over the years. I've done hundreds of photo shoots with all different kinds of models and characters and people. And this video comes from the outtakes from that. So I'm actually really, really excited about it. It's a new direction for me and it's fun.
Well, we look forward to all of that, but more of your art, Kathryn. But for now, I want to thank you very much for taking time to come on the podcast. I really enjoyed our conversation.
Thank you, Chris. Thank you. I'm sure I'll be, in hindsight, one of the darker ones. I'm laughing now at myself opening up with my stories of all these pets meeting their demise. So there it is.
Thank you so much, Kathryn.
Okay. Thank you, Chris.
And you can find links to Kathryn's website and social media in the show notes accompanying this episode. You can also find us on Instagram at the Art Podcast. That's art with two A's. And if you'd like to leave your comments and questions or suggestions for guests to come on the program, then please do drop us a line to hollowellstudios@gmail.com, or you can send us a message on Instagram. And as always, if you have a moment when you're on Apple Podcasts, please do leave us a 5-star rating and a review, because that helps our rankings, which in turn helps others find the show. And we have many more wonderful guests lined up for you, including Nazafari Lotfi, Jenna Lewis, Vinnie Bagwell, Christian Joy, and Robin Antar, to name just a few. My thanks again to Kathryn Andrews and to you for listening. I'll be back next week with another episode, so I hope you'll join me then.